Hello everyone. Today's topic is fermentation and design of fermenter. Here we'll be studying about what are the different types of fermentations which are being carried out in industries to produce various products at a higher level. Right. So myself, Dr. A. Madhuri, Assistant Professor of Microbiology from Government Degree College for Women, Begumpet. So first, let us try to know what is fermentation. So what is fermentation? The term fermentation is derived from the Latin verb fervere, which means to boil. Okay, so first meaning of fermentation is to boil. And in industrial microbiology, fermentation means any large-scale microbial process carried out in a production vessel. This production vessel is called as fermenter. Okay, so in other words, whatever we are producing in fermenter is called as a fermentation, or a large-scale process which is being carried out for production of different microbial processes, or the microorganisms are producing some product. Next, industrial fermentation is comprised of two main stages: upstream processing and downstream processing. So first thing is industrial fermentation, means the fermentation which is being carried out at industrial level will be having two stages. Okay, what are these stages? One is upstream processing and the other one is downstream processing. Upstream processing means going up, right? So the processes which are being carried out in the starting of the fermentation can be called as upstream processing. Like if you want to produce any product in larger scale, first you have to prepare the culture, because we are talking about microbial processes, or we are talking about the products which are being produced by the microorganisms. So definitely we have to use microorganisms in this production processes, right? So when we want to use these microorganisms, and that too at larger scale, first we should have a pure culture with us. It may be a slant, or it may be a plate, or it may be a broth tube or broth flask, right? So first we have to build up this inoculum into larger scale, because we can't add 5 ml culture or 10 ml culture into lakhs of gallons of media, right? So definitely the volume of the inoculum will be very high. So first we have to increase the volume of this inoculum, or volume of the culture what we have to use in this fermentation process. Okay, so how to increase this volume, right? First, if you have a slant, from that you have to transfer it into a broth of 100 ml, right? Then you have to go for 250 ml. Then 1 liter, then 5 liters, then 10 liters. Likewise, you have to increase the volume of the inoculum, or the culture which you want to inoculate into the fermentation media. So appropriate, there will be some particular ratio for any fermentation process. For this, the inoculum percentage may be 1%, 2%, 10% or 20% also in some cases. So accordingly, we have to be ready with our inoculum and also the fermentation media. So these processes, all these processes are called as upstream, will come under upstream process or upstream processing. Next is downstream processing. What is downstream processing? Is once the fermentation is done, okay, our job is not complete with the fermentation process, right? After fermentation process, we have to extract the product also, because we are not concerned with the broth having the product. We should get some pure product in our hand. That is the purpose of carrying out the fermentation. So whatever we are going to do to purify the product which was produced in that fermenter comprises of downstream processing. It may be filtration or precipitation, centrifugation, drying, whatever the process we have to do to get the purified product at the end, all these processes, all these steps will come under this downstream processing. So I hope you are very clear with the terms upstream processing and downstream processing. Upstream processing are the processes which are carried at the starting of the fermentation, like inoculum building, etc. And downstream processing will be the processes which are carried at the end of the fermentation, like extraction of the product. Next. So USP, upstream processing, consists of three main areas. One is producer microorganism. We have talked about it. Next, fermentation media. We have to prepare media in a larger scale, that too under controlled conditions, like the media should be sterile. And other fermentation processes, like there will be conditions, specialized conditions required for different fermentations, like temperature, oxygen, pH, aeration, many more factors will be there. All these factors must be controlled. So this all things will come under upstream processing. And downstream processing, as I told you, it involves a harvesting cell disruption. Cell harvesting means we are separating the cells from the media. Cell disruption, it is done sometimes when the product is intracellular. Okay, the product is intracellular. So then we have to definitely break the cells to get the product extracted. And then extraction, concentration, purification, and drying, all these steps will come under downstream processing. Next. So what we have understood, what is fermentation, we have understood what is upstream processing and what is downstream processing, and what are the different processes involved in both these terminology, right? Next. So we have to study now what are the different types of fermentation. Okay, so in this first one is solid state fermentation, next is submerged fermentation, third is surface fermentation, fourth is aerobic fermentation, and the last one is anaerobic fermentation. So these are the five types of fermentation which are being carried out. So let us study each type of fermentation in detail. First one is solid state fermentation. Here solid state fermentation means growth of microorganisms at the surface of solid substrate in absence or near absence of free water. Okay, so here as the name shows, solid state, first you can concentrate on this word solid state. So means here water is not there. Water is there, but very minimum in nature. Okay. So we are growing microorganisms at the surface of the, we are using some solid substrate and we are growing the microorganisms at the surface of the substrate, solid substrate. Okay. In the absence or near absence of free water. In the absence means, one thing we can you can understand here, whatever substrate you are taking, you have to moist the substrate using water. You have to make the substrate moist with water, right? And there should not be any free water. Free water should not be there. Then only we can call it as a solid state fermentation. And it is also called as substrate fermentation and is older than submerged fermentation. Solid state fermentation is also called as substrate fermentation. And this fermentation is older than submerged fermentation. Right. Traditional substrates used are agricultural products such as rice, wheat, maize, soybean, etc. We are using all these substrates such as rice, wheat, maize, soybean, agricultural waste we are using in this fermentation. Next. These provide rich and complex source of nutrients which may or may not be supplemented. When we are using these agricultural waste, one thing is these waste will be utilized in a proper manner and they won't give waste. And the next is they will be having some nutrients in it. They will provide some rich and complex nutrients. In some cases, extra nutrients may be supplemented, or in some cases, nutrients may not be supplemented, right? Next is large number of fungi, actinomycetes or bacillus strains can be used. In solid state fermentation, all these microorganisms are used, and solid substrates are mixed with inoculum and placed within a fermenter to form a solid substrate bed. So here we have to prepare a bed kind of thing using different substrates, right? Then most processes are aerobic. So here solid state fermentation, most processes are aerobic, and the major carbon sources are usually complex carbohydrates, example starch and cellulose. Here the carbon sources which we are using are mostly starch and cellulose, and microorganisms release hydrolytic enzymes into the substrate that release soluble sugars from the complex carbohydrates. Here microorganisms are releasing some enzymes, hydrolytic enzymes. Hydrolytic means, hydro means water, lytic means breaking. So breaking the compounds in presence of water. So such enzymes will be released by microorganisms which help in breakdown of the substrate. So by this digestion, they will be releasing some soluble sugars from the complex carbohydrates. These soluble sugars are taken up by the microorganisms that convert them into new biomass. Okay, so these microorganisms will take up that sugars, and they will build up some new biomass. These reactions are exothermic, and microbial growth releases waste metabolic heat. So when all these reactions are taking place, heat will be released. Okay, and this heat, the removal of which this heat can be removed by conduction, convection or evaporation. So these processes will help in removal of heat. Next is solid state fermentations on large scale use stationary or rotary trays. Okay, here solid state fermentations are using stationary or rotary trays, and in these trays temperature and humidity control is circulated through the stacked solids. Okay, so in this arrangement of stacked trays, temperature and humidity must be controlled at a particular level to carry out the fermentation in a successful manner. Next, less frequently, rotary drum types fermenters are used for solid state fermentation. Sometimes rotary drums are also used. Examples of the products which are produced by solid state fermentation are amylase. Next is citric acid. Okay, amylase is produced by azospirillum, Aspergillus oryzae, and the substrate here is rice, and this amylase is an enzyme. Next is citric acid. For production of citric acid, cooked vegetable residues are being used, and the organism is the fungus Aspergillus nicer, and this citric acid is an organic acid. And next, what are the advantages of using solid state fermentation? The product titer will be very high, means if you are producing enzymes, the enzyme production will be very high. Whatever the product is, the product titer will be very high when compared to the submerged fermentation, and it utilizes low capital and recurring expenditure. When we are saying it utilizes low capital, means money involvement or expenditure involvement is very low, and low energy requirement is very less. Foam formation is not there. In submerged fermentation, foam is a major problem, but here foam formation is not there. And simple fermentation media will be very simple, less fermentation space, as we can use stacked trays. The space occupied by for this fermentation will also be less, and easier aeration, as we are taking open tray system. Like that, aeration will be very easy, and no need of rigorous regulation of fermentation parameters. For submerged fermentation, there will be a very rigorous controlling of different parameters, whereas for solid state fermentation, there is no requirement of such parameters in a very strict manner, and easy control of contaminants. Like the water ratio or the water level is very less in solid state fermentation, or as there is no free water at all, chance for contaminants to grow in these substrates is very less. So the risk of contamination is less. Next is disadvantages. Here, disadvantages include excess heat release. So due to metabolic activities, heat will be released, right? So as the substrate is solid in nature, where this heat has to go, the heat won't be released from the substrate easily, and there can be additional contamination by fungi and bacteria. As I said, there is no free water or less free water, most of the contaminants won't grow, but rarely there are chances for fungi and bacteria to grow in such conditions, because our inoculum, whatever we are using, that is also a microorganism, and that microorganism is able to grow. Some of the microorganisms can also grow, so some care must be taken, and use of limited microbial types. So only few types of microorganisms can only grow in these types of fermentation, and expensive pretreatment of substrate. So sometimes whatever substrate we are using, it must be pre-treated to remove some harmful chemicals or contaminants from the substrate, and pH control, as we are talking about the solid substrate, there will be problem with maintaining the pH in the substrate uniformly. Okay, if we are taking agricultural waste, we can try to maintain the pH uniformly, but we can't be sure that every inch, every part of this solid substrate is having the same pH. We can't assure that. So uniformity in the pH can't is a problem, and almost being impossible. Right, higher power requirement for continuous agitation and a difficult. Higher power requirement for continuous agitation and difficult control of moisture content of the medium. So agitation is not, it is required manually, we have to do, or through machinery also we can do to for the uniform mixing of the contents and for maintaining some parameters in the media. And it is difficult to control moisture content of the medium, because during fermentation, first thing is heat will be released. So due to this heat, the substrate will get dried up, or due to time also, the substrate will get dried up. So when the substrate gets dried up, the moisture level in the medium will differ. Okay, so we have to maintain the one of the important parameter is moisture level also. So yeah, sometimes it will be become difficult for maintaining that constant moisture level throughout the fermentation period. So that is one of the important point what we have to consider. And next type of fermentation is solid state fermentation. In submerged fermentation, or it is also called as liquid fermentation. First fermentation what we have studied is solid state fermentation. So submerged fermentation is called as liquid fermentation, right? Next, here fermentation medium containing microbial cells in dispersed state throughout the medium. When we are taking fermentation medium, microbial cells can be present in this medium in dispersed state, means the cells are uniformly distributed throughout the media. Nowadays, submerged culture methods are widely used in the production of enzymes. So maybe solid state fermentation was first developed, but submerged fermentation is much in is in wide use for the production of different products from microorganisms, especially enzymes. And the fermentation equipment used is the same like in like solid state fermentation as in the manufacture of antibiotics. It is critical tank which is made up of stainless steel. Okay, here we have to use we in solid state fermentation we have used rotary drums or trays, but here we have to use some fermenters. Okay, well equipped fermenters must be used in submerged fermentation, where these fermenters are made of stainless steel tanks, which are mostly cylindrical in nature. Next is the tank. Whatever fermenter we are using, it is equipped with agitation and aeration device and a cooling system. When we are talking about fermenter, it is it is a container where fermentation has to be carried out. So that fermenter, it is not just a tank, it should have some accessories to maintain some parameters such as for agitation. Agitation means mixing of the contents. For that, agitator it should be there, and aerating device. Aerating device means to provide air into the media. That is, a sparger will be there, and the cooling system on the fermentation tank. There will be a jacket where water will be circulated. With this, the temperature can be maintained in the fermentation medium. The medium contains energy source, carbon source, and nitrogen source, and any special growth requirements. So whatever media we are using, definitely it should have carbon source, nitrogen source, and also energy source. And some other special nutrients if they are required by the microorganisms, whatever we are using for that process. Next, media is sterilized by keeping it 1200 degrees centigrade for 1 to 2 hours, 120 degrees. First, it has to be sterilized. And here, citric acid and penicillium fermentations are examples. And for submerged fermentation, we can use two types of fermenters: stirred tank fermenters or tower fermenters. And these submerged fermenters are run as a batch fermentation, fed batch fermentation, and continuous fermentation. Now let us try to understand what are this batch fermentation, etc. So coming to the first one, batch fermentation, as the name suggests, batch means separated one. Okay, one batch, right? It is a closed culture system, right? Closed culture system is here you are adding everything in the initial stage. At once we have to add, whether it is a culture media, any addition, anti-foaming agents, whatever you want to add, you have to add it in the initial stages itself. It won't be, it can't be disturbed in the middle, and the fermentation can only stop at the end of the fermentation process, right? So this is a closed culture system. Once you are adding everything, you are closing the system. That is why it is called as closed culture system, right? So what are you are supposed to add at the start? Microbial inoculum we have to add, fermentation media you have to add, other components in specific amounts are also required to be added at the starting. Next, they are not replenished once the fermentation starts. Once the fermentation starts, you are not supposed to disturb the contents. It has to be run till the end. The product is recovered at the end of the process following the cleaning and sterilization of the fermenter, so that the latter can be used for another batch fermentation process. Okay, so when you can recover the product, only at the end of the fermentation. Next, in this fermentation, microorganisms grow at a rapid rate in the initial stages in the presence of excess nutrients, but as they multiply in large numbers, they use up the nutrients and secrete toxic metabolites, which retard further growth of the microorganism. So fermentation, it is starting at a particular point of time. It will run up to a particular time, right? So during this process, what happens is, initially the microorganisms which are present in the fermenter, initially the nutrient concentration will be very high. So the microorganisms will try to utilize these nutrients very fastly and try to grow very fastly. But as the time goes on, the nutrient concentration decreases and toxic metabolites concentration will increase in the fermentation media. Okay, so when these toxins increase in the media, the rate, growth rate of the microorganisms will come down. So this is a process which is happening in the batch fermentation. So based on this, there are different phases in batch fermentation. These are lag phase, log phase, exponential phase, and stationary lag phase, log phase, stationary phase, and death phase. There are alternative names also for log phase is also called as exponential phase, and then stationary phase and death or decline phase. When a data on the increase of cell number at various intervals of time during each of the four phases is collected and plotted in two ways, a characteristic growth curve is found. So when we plot a graph using the cell number increase during this process of batch fermentation, we can get a growth curve. We can get a curve here, graph like this, in this fashion. This is called as growth curve. Here you can see these are the number of on y-axis you have to take number of cells, and x-axis you have to take time. So according to the time, the number of how this cell number is increasing. So you can see this is the lag phase, initial phase. There is no much increase in the cell number, and then log phase, gradual cell number is increased, and stationary phase, the number of cells has is constant, and then decline phase, the number of cells is decreasing. So these are the four different phases. Now let us try to understand each phase in detail. And coming to the lag phase, lag phase represents a time of adaptation after inoculation, during which the microbial cells prepare for multiplication, synthesizing DNA, various inducible enzymes, and other macromolecules required for cell division. Okay, so lag phase, what is happening in lag phase is when we are adding inoculum into the media, first the microbial cells which are being added into the media, they will try to adjust to the new conditions or acclimatize to the new environment, right? So this process will take some time. So during this adaptation period, what they will do is they will prepare for multiplication. They won't multiply, but they will prepare for multiplication. Like they, for multiplication, they need DNA content, like their whatever chromosome is there, it has to be doubled, and enzymes must be produced, and other macromolecules are also required for cell division.